Let's face it, failing a certification exam sucks. Now, hopefully that's something you'll never have to experience, but it's inevitable that some of you watching this video right now will fail the certification exam if you've not done so already. Even I've failed a couple of times. Naturally, as the sharp pain of failure begins to dull, a question will emerge from the pained depths of your soul. How did this happen? Well, it's pretty obvious, quite honestly, you didn't prepare yourself sufficiently to pass that exam. Now, some people don't want to hear that. They spent money on training courses, books, practice exams. They spent hours and hours watching videos on YouTube and other platforms. They've even taken the time to try and actually work with the materials that the exam covers. They've done everything they've been told to do. How dare anyone say that they were not sufficiently prepared? How is it their fault? When you sit down at that exam, whether at an exam center or at home, there's no one else there but you. The first step in effectively preparing for your exam retake is to take personal responsibility for the outcome. The guidance that exam vendor provides detailing what candidates are expected to know is usually pretty clear. While it's certainly possible that a course of training might not sufficiently cover all aspects of an exam, those content creators won't be taking the exam for you. If you want to own the outcome of successfully passing an exam, then you need to ensure that you also take ownership of how you prepare for that exam. One good thing about failing a certification exam, especially if it's your first time taking it, is now you've actually experienced what that exam is like. You've seen a sampling of the questions from the subject pool, and you might now recognize aspects of the subject areas to incorporate into your studies that you weren't even aware of before taking that exam. Next, you should identify the areas of the exam where you underperformed. Many, but not all, exams provide some sort of feedback about your performance in different major subject areas that were covered on the exam. Using this, you can return to the exam guide and prioritize those areas for review. Review your study habits. You can have all the best materials in the world available for study, but you also need to set aside consistent and sufficient time and space to make the most of them. Ensure that you have good and current training materials. If you're considering following a published course of study for a certification, ensure that you're using a reliable source, perhaps the vendor themselves, or a vendor-recognized training partner. Don't utilize exam dumps from the internet. Not only are these from unauthorized sources, their information may be incorrect or out of date. Using exam dumps is also a violation of many certification agreements. And if a vendor concludes that you used an exam dump as part of your exam prep, they could revoke all certifications that they have awarded to you. Not everyone has the same learning style. Figure out what yours is, and try to find or create study practices that leverage it. The nature of the internet makes it easy to deliver written or video content, but those might not be the most effective for you. Some people need more hands-on. Some people learn best by moving their bodies. I know there are songs about cloud services out there. Why not AWS dances on TikTok? Why not Serverless the musical? Sorry. Also, studying content from the perspective of different learning styles provides additional reinforcement because the information is being experienced simultaneously by different neural paths in your brain. Instead of just reading documentation in your head, read out loud to engage your audio learning. Instead of typing your notes electronically on a keyboard, add some muscle memory by taking notes with a stylus or even pencil and paper. Try explaining what you're studying to something else in the room, like a pet or a rubber duck, or a study partner. It's been said in many places that the best way to learn a subject is to teach that subject to others. Find additional sources of information. For many popular certification exams, you can find any number of websites, blog posts, or videos covering those exam topics. However, not every content creator will approach the same subject in exactly the same way. It is entirely possible that someone else's explanation about a topic that you're struggling with might be phrased in just the right way to finally make that connection for you. Along those same lines, never be afraid to ask questions or to ask for help. It's a safe bet that for any certification that you might be pursuing, there's at least one forum or a discussion board out there on the internet where you can find the answers to your questions. Some companies provide practice exams. Sometimes these might be from the exam vendor, but more often are from a third party. Just like any other form of training material, if you choose to use practice exams, ensure that they come from a reliable source. I find good practice exams to be incredibly valuable, but also potentially dangerous. On the good side, practice exams can expose you to how the exam vendors phrase their questions. Many questions will not be straightforward, and an exam writer's use of certain phrases may not be as you might normally use them. Being able to speak exam in the dialect of that exam vendor can help you more easily identify the important aspects of a question. Practice exams also put you under stress, providing you with a time limit, which can help you learn to use your time in the exam effectively, and they usually have a higher requirement for a passing score. It's been proven that a little bit of stress helps people learn. Along those lines, if you're using a practice exam in a study mode, the sting of getting an answer wrong comes with immediate feedback. Why was that answer the wrong answer? Why is the correct answer the correct one? And hopefully explanations about the other answers as well. Personally, I find this aspect of practice exams to be the most useful. But the danger of practice exams is that they only have so many questions to show you. Part of the use of practice exams is to repeat them until you're consistently passing with as high of a score as possible. This means that, inevitably, you'll begin to recognize questions right from the first sentence or two, and will immediately remember the correct answer to that question from your prior practice attempts. Don't try to memorize answers. Once this starts to happen, it means you have stopped analyzing that question for details and stopped evaluating the answers in order to identify the correct ones. How is this dangerous? For many certification exams, especially dealing with information technology, changing just a single word in a question might mean a previously incorrect answer is now the correct one. If you get into the habit of seeing a question phrased a certain way and reflexively look for a specific answer for that question when you see a similarly worded question on the actual exam, the reflex to select the right answer that was correct on the practice exam might take over. If that happens, you might miss that the question is actually just different enough for that correct answer to be wrong in that circumstance. So, when you're taking your practice exams, take your time. Read every question and answer thoroughly. Do this with the goal of building an understanding of the possible circumstances around the subject of the question and how each answer can apply to that subject, both in the current circumstances of the question you're looking at right now and in other common circumstances that might arise in different questions involving the same subject. Some answers may have absolutely nothing to do with the subject of the question at all, but other answers might actually be valid for that subject if the circumstances in the question are changed just a little bit. While speed on your practice exam run should not be a priority while you're trying to gain subject mastery, you will eventually need to be able to get through the practice exams within the official time allowed. Some of the higher level certification exams are extremely text heavy, so at some point, you will need to ensure that you are managing your time effectively during the practice exams. If reading will be an additional challenge for you during the exam, perhaps because you are not a native speaker of the language used for the exam, or have a condition such as dyslexia that makes reading more of a challenge, you should be able to ask the exam vendor for an accommodation, giving you a little more time to get through the exam. While practice exams are a valuable part of exam prep, being able to apply the concepts that you are studying are a critical aspect of both gaining and demonstrating mastery of the subject material. Where appropriate, take the time to implement what you are studying in real environments, ideally as many times as you can, to gain familiarity with how the subject matter is actually employed in the real world. Despite a great deal of study, some people will encounter situations during the exam where they second-guess themselves for an answer they gave to an earlier question. The best preparation for this is to be extremely confident with your studies. The more you know, the more easily you'll be able to recognize distinct aspects of a question that clearly indicate what the correct answer is. Nevertheless, second-guessing can happen to anyone. However, studies have shown that in most cases where people choose to go back and change an answer that they have lost confidence in, their initial answer was usually correct. The process of doubting yourself and then returning to an earlier question also takes up time that you could be using to answer more questions in the exam. So if this happens to you, ask yourself, are the reasons why you selected that first answer still valid? If so, trust yourself, leave it alone, and move on. One other thing to be aware of is the exam vendor's retake policies. Most importantly, how long you have to wait before retaking the same exam. Some vendors may make you wait quite some time, Cisco, for example, requires you to wait 180 days before reattempting an exam. AWS, on the other hand, only requires you to wait 14 days. Different vendors may also have different policies that come into effect if you have failed to pass the exam after some number of consecutive attempts. Finally, and most importantly of all, don't give up. Certification exams aren't easy. They shouldn't be, but they're not impossible. So, if you've recently failed a certification exam, you've got a little bit of time to take a breath, clear your head, think about the points that I've brought up in this video, and then get back into training for your next attempt at that exam. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.